Welcome. I'm Jonathan Morgan, Senior Minister of First Congregational Church of Eugene, and I am delighted you have joined us for this first service of Christmastide. As we come into this time together, let us prepare our hearts and minds to receive God's promise of healing and hope and joy as revealed in the birth of Jesus. We are truly blessed to have two special guest worship leaders for our service. Corinne Esridge and Molly Mitchell are seminarians at Yale Divinity School. That's where our own Averyn Payne is attending seminary, and they're all three friends. Corinne is in her third and final year, and Molly is in her second year. Corinne hails from Northern Virginia in the Washington, D.C. metro area and moved around quite a bit in her first career as a museum curator. Molly grew up in north central Wisconsin, lived in Portland prior to heading out to seminary, and is a member of the Bridgeport UCC Church in Portland. Molly and I served on the Central Pacific Conference Board of Directors when I was the moderator. She also served in the Justice and Witness Ministry team a few years ago. Molly coordinated the conference's Starling Project, a new initiative to help our churches of this conference come together in all their unique and powerful ways. They are both members in discernment in the United Church of Christ and are preparing for congregational ministry. It is so wonderful having them share their gifts with us. So, please join me now in our call to worship. Since the beginning, God has been relentlessly pursuing us in love. Though our faithfulness ebbs and flows, God's love endures forever. Taking on flesh like ours, God became one with humanity in the person of Jesus Christ. God lived and moved and ministered in the margins of power. God incarnate was not what we expected. We did not recognize God in Jesus. Still, we struggle to recognize God with us. And yet, God continues to dwell in our midst. Thanks be to God. M. Barclay wrote our opening poem entitled Epiphany. Searching for a glimpse of change, seeking liberation from colonizing forces, the Magi journeyed, crossing foreign lands and borders, with only a star as their guide. The same glimmer of hope that guided their way calls to us today. Through night skies and morning dew, through community and in silent meditation, through songs ancient and new, through art and bodies and creation, through collectives of people who dare to break rules in the direction of a better world, it calls us to come and share our resources equitably, to come and delight in love enfleshed, to come and join in the spirit of deliverance birthed far from the centers of power at the birth site of God. The way is revealed.
We pray for blessings. We pray for peace. Comfort for family. Protection while we sleep. We pray for healing. Prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand. give us lesser things? What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise?
Our scripture reading comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who's been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising, and we have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means the least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel."
Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out. And there, ahead of them, went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road.
And themes today in worship were inspired by the current event of the Christmas star. We note the similarity to the stories surrounding the Epiphany, when the Magi noticed a peculiar star in the sky and traveled in search of the Messiah, whose birth it heralded. The Magi are sometimes called kings, but they were closer to scholars and scientists. They were wise ones who studied the stars and cosmic movements and interpreted their meaning. Many cultures have traditions, or did have them in the past, that believed planetary movements to interact with life and community events. Even while the cosmos seems so vast and mysterious, we could imagine ourselves connected to matter and movements that are hundreds of millions of miles away. We have been experiencing some rare celestial moments recently. Maybe you've been following. In addition to the turn from diminishing light to gathering light marked by the winter solstice, there was also the great conjunction, the night when Jupiter and Saturn were most closely observable together in the sky since medieval times. Some called this the Christmas star, for the way the two planets appeared together like one bright star,
and perhaps also in connection to the story of the Magi. Astrologer Chani Nicholas comments about the multiple layers of cosmic significance in these events. She writes, occurring on the solstice, which in and of itself is already considered a fresh start and a day to set intentions that will hopefully grow alongside the returning light and warmth of the sun, the Great Conjunction feels like a blessing in a year devoid of them. The star that the Magi saw may have been, in fact, a planetary conjunction, just like the one we recently experienced. It is not often easy to hold transcendence, the majesty, the out-there-ness of God, alongside an intention with imminence, the closer than your next breath experiences of God. The wise ones in the Epiphany story give us a way into this mystery. In the scripture passage, the Magi believed enough that the cosmos out there was revealing a Messiah born down here that they risked the journey of likely hundreds of miles to go see for themselves. The stars may have sent them on their journey, but the promise of God incarnated in a baby and born of a human woman is what pushed them to travel all those miles. If we spend a moment thinking about it, there are many ways that we hold this transcendence imminence tension, probably without being much aware of it. As we are making our way through this COVID pandemic, we encounter unimaginable numbers of those who have died, numbers of daily infection rates, all of which are difficult to capture in an understandable way. At the same time, I feel as though my life is lived to a great extent around safety precautions that protect myself and my quarantine pod. More of us know someone who is or was gravely ill or who has died of COVID complications. It is a combination of experiences that are both everyday and unimaginable at the same time.
I've been paying attention to the news lately. Perhaps you have too. I saw what went down in Salem on Monday, the way that illegal vigilante groups of white supremacists have fully come out of the shadows and into the light of day to threaten the bodies of black and brown siblings and our lawmakers. It seems like it should be unconscionable, unimaginable, but instead it's predictable. It is the everyday. My heart trembles a little bit, wondering how far these gun and bear spray wielding folks might go, being so emboldened after being told to stand by our lame duck president. And I wonder, stand by for what? I look out the window at the trees whose leaves have fallen now. I can see so much farther into the middle distance now, and I try to imagine what the freeway would look like with militarized checkpoints. It's business as usual, though. I don't see a cavalry coming. My uncertainty, though, drives me to scripture and other historical texts for clues. From our scripture reading earlier, I want to repeat a section. When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him. From ancestral texts like these, we see clearly the movements of threatened leaders. Herod was frightened. He wanted to ameliorate or get rid of the cause of that fear. It didn't matter that he felt threatened by a baby and ordered his troops to stand by for infanticide of all babies assigned male at birth. The fears of powerful men often result in unimaginable suffering. Speaking of terrified leaders, I've been paying attention to the news lately. Maybe you have too. I saw this week that there's been a significant hack into the critical infrastructure of our country. The way that national security looks today has changed a lot in the last few decades. It's honestly right under our fingertips. Right in the palm of our hand lies the ability to connect up into space and back down into one another's palms. The information sent and received, pinging back and forth trillions of times, each offers a bit of information, collects data and everything about our locations, our shopping interests, and our connectedness, and our vulnerabilities, is for sale. With the ability to call forth a response to his deepest fears and insecurities, Putin, like Herod, put out a call. His call was not to the magi of old, but to data scientists and computer programmers to learn more about when and where and how, the specifics of American need happen. We know now that they've been in for months, gathering data, standing by. And I wonder again, stand by for what? I look out the window again. This time it was at night, so I could see the moon rising over a distant hill, and I thought about all the satellites, the pieces floating up in space that somehow help us live our tiny lives down here. I don't know how they work. So my uncertainties, mounting, again drove me right back to scripture. Earlier we read, "Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. And then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage.'" The Magi told Herod when and where and how the perceived threat would arrive. His order to them to go and see and report back would offer the confirmation he needed to quash the menace. If Russia sees America as this type of threat, then the fears of powerful men will escalate the everyday, the unimaginable suffering to which we've increasingly become numb. And speaking of being numb to suffering, I've been paying attention to the news lately. Maybe you have too? It feels like if I can just keep scanning my feed, I can just keep clicking refresh, checking the notifications, I'll know what I need to know about what is to come. Because surely some brave journalist out there is watching what needs to be watched, documenting what we need to know about, and writing like they need to put everyone on standby. But standby for what? I gaze out at the crisp, clear night sky and take in the stars in their galaxies, set there but also in motion, as the uncertainties of our precarious humanity pile up. I urge you and myself to take a deep breath, to look out your own window, to look to your scriptures and to the stories that have heralded both miraculous God with us right alongside the suffering of the innocents, the slaughter of toddlers. Jesus was not born into certainty, and neither were we.
To conclude, We will read a piece that alternates scripture readings with excerpts from a Scientific American article. It is not often easy to live in the tension of the out there, the far away cosmic workings, the systems around us, and the right here, how we arrange our daily movements and live in our bodies. I am reading from Genesis, Amos, the Gospel of Mark, Isaiah, and Psalms.
And I am reading from Scientific American by Jennifer A. Francis, published in 2018.
God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth." And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars.
The Arctic climate is changing rapidly, breaking at least a dozen major records in the past 3 years.
The one who made the constellations, Pleiades and Orion, the one who turns midnight into dawn, darkens the day into night, the one who calls for the waters of the sea and pours them out on the surface of the earth. This is our God.
Sea ice is disappearing. Air temperatures are soaring.
And the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken.
Permafrost is thawing. Glaciers are melting.
For the stars of the heavens and their constellations will not give their light. The sun will be dark at its rising, and the moon will not shed its light.
The swift warming is altering the jet stream and polar vortex, prolonging heat waves, droughts, deep freezes, and heavy rains worldwide.
When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them? Mortals that you care for them?
From celestial bodies to our very own, we see cycles of life and death, movement and energy. Within the concept of an immanent God, a God with us, moves God out of the heavenly realms and right alongside us in our creaky, worn, Zoom-fatigued bodies this day.
Gave us these bodies and you called them good. You gave us these bodies and you called them good. We are easily damaged. Have you seen the scars? That's just scratching the surface, more beneath where those are. Gave us these bodies and you called them good. You gave us these bodies and you called them good. May we love them as you do. Let us love them as you do. Inside out. We do so much damage. Have you seen the scars? We keep hurting each other. Sometimes that's just how we are. You gave us these bodies and you called them good. You gave us these bodies and you called them good. May we love them as you do. Let us love them as you do. Inside, outside, through and through. Let us love them as you do. The
fearful, you're wonderfully made. Don't believe the lies some say. No, our flesh and bones, our hearts and hands are loved in every way. Yeah, our flesh and bones, our hearts and hands are loved in every way. You gave us these bodies and you called them good. You gave us these bodies and you called them good. May we love them as you do.
May the peace that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge of the love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ.
And may the blessing of our immanent God, who created you, redeemed you, and will forever sustain you, be with you now and forever. Amen.
You gave us these bodies and you called them good. You gave us these bodies and you called them good. We are easily damaged. Have you seen the scars? That's just scratching the surface, more beneath where those are. You gave us these bodies and you called them good. You gave us these bodies and you called them